Om Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam. Om. Today we will take a glimpse of the Diamond Sutra, which is also called Vajrachedika Prajnaparamita Sutra of Gautama Buddha. This talk was given by Osho about 40 to 45 years ago. The talk was originally given by Gautama Buddha in Shravasti. That was about 2,500 years ago. 500 years before the birth of Christ, early in the morning, this sutra was born. This sutra, the name of the word Vajra here does not mean diamond. Vajra here means a thunderbolt, lightning. Chedika means to sever, means to cut. Prajna means wisdom. Paramita means the highest form of wisdom. We call our guru Parama. Parama means the highest. So the highest form of a wisdom, which comes in the form of a thunderbolt, which is capable of cutting us and slicing us. That means it is also translated as the perfection of wisdom, which cuts like a thunderbolt. The important thing is that we need to allow. If you allow, a Buddha can cut you like a thunderbolt. This sutra becomes meaningful only to those who are very receptive, to those who allow. Because a Buddha can kill you and also help you to be born. This is the meaning of the word Vija. Vija means the one who is twice born. A Buddha does two jobs. He kills and he also resurrects. And this is the season of the time of Lent. This is in the Christian history, Jesus was killed on Friday and on a Sunday he was resurrected. So that is the symbolism that to be reborn, that is the meaning of the word Dvija. I will read the sutra. These sutras are very, very repetitive for a particular reason. And because it is so repetitive, I will not read the entire sutra. Thus I have heard at one time, the Lord dwelt at Shravasti. Early in the morning, the Lord dressed, put on his cloak, took his bowl and entered the great city of Shravasti to collect alms. Osho begins by giving a great description of the greatness of Buddha and how he relates to Buddha. His opening words were, I love Gautama the Buddha. I love him not because he is the founder of Buddhism. He is not the founder of Buddhism. Buddhism is a byproduct. It did not happen in his lifetime. Many years later, Buddhism happened. He is the founder of a religionless religion. What do you mean by a religionless religion? A religionless religion means a religion in which there is no God, no prayer, no heaven, no hell. This is, when many people try to translate the Buddhist scriptures, they were finding out what kind of a religion this, a religion without God, without prayer, without heaven, without hell. And that's why it is called a religionless religion. Buddha's message, therefore, in a way, is very scientific and considered the deepest ever. He only cares for the truth. He has not compromised on the truth. Now, for the sake of our understanding, he does not come down. And therefore, in a way, because he has not compromised on the truth, he does not, in a way, care whether you have understood or not. He does not give any ideals, no ideologies, because all ideologies come from the mind. The whole of the Buddhist concept is to go beyond the mind. Whenever you have an ideology, you are split. You are one thing and you want to become something other than what you are. And whenever you are split, you cannot be happy. Instead of giving you something, he takes everything from you. He takes away your own self. There is a great difference by listening to a Buddhist sutra or listening to our Swamiji speak. When Swamiji speaks, by the end of the talk, you have so much notes, so much literature, so many new stories, so many new concepts, new ideas. On the other hand, you may listen to hours for Osho or to a Buddha, and you come with a feeling of what have I got? And that is the feeling you are going to have at the end of the talk, because there is nothing that you're going to get in the form of an information. This is what H.G. Wells had said on Buddha. He is the most godly and the most godless man in the whole of history. Why godly? Because he has led more people to God, and godless because he never talks about God. Buddha is not an atheist, but he never talks about God, because even to say something about God, you have said something. This sutra was born in Shravasti. Almost all the Buddhist sutras were born in Shravasti. This was born one fine morning 2,500 years ago. Buddha stayed in Shravasti for 25 years. Out of 45 years after his enlightenment, he stayed in Shravasti for 25 years. Osho says he must have loved the city immensely. Those of us who are interested to see all the places where the Buddha walked, where the Buddha talked. If there is one town that you need to go to, is Gorakhpur, which is the ultimate, the northmost or the northmost station, railway station in Uttar Pradesh, which is on the UP-Nepal border. A short distance from Gorakhpur is a town called Lumbini. Lumbini, which is just across the border in Nepal, where Buddha was born. And again, a short distance from there is Kushinagar. And towards the west is the town of Shravasti. The other famous town that you could visit if you want to get the feel of Buddha is whenever you're traveling to Patna or to Ranchi. Bodh Gaya comes between Patna and Ranchi. And near Bodh Gaya is a place also, the Nalanda, where the Nalanda University was. And very close to Nalanda is a place called Rajgir. At Rajgir, Buddha spent a lot of time. There is a small hill called the Vulture's Peak, where Buddha would have done a lot of meditation in that place. Another town to visit where Buddha spoke is Saranath. Saranath is about 10 kilometers from Varanasi. And Buddha delivered his first sermon at that place. I need to share with you a story, because which is very central to understanding of Buddhist sutras. To many of my friends, I have shared this story many times. This is a story of a certain businessman from India who travels to Africa. And after his business, his friend tells him, outside this town, you have speaking parrots. Would you like to see them? He said, I've never heard of speaking parrots. And he was amazed to see parrots actually speaking. And he said, people in India have never seen speaking parrots. Can I take one of them back home? So his friend managed to catch one of these parrots, put them in a cage, and he brought him back to India. As this was an African parrot, the businessman from India took very good care, gave the best of nuts, spoke to him every day. And it became 2 years. He had a chance to go back to Africa. And when he was going back, he said, do you have any message for my friends? So the bird in the cage told him, tell them I'm happy in my cage. So the message was, please tell them I'm happy in my cage. So when he went back to the place where the parrots were, he announced to them, 2 years ago, I had taken one of your friends from here. He has a message for you. And the message he has for you is, I'm happy in my cage. Listening to this, one of the birds fall down dead. So he was very amazed. I all just gave them some good news. With a heavy heart, he comes back to India and he reports to his friend in the cage, the parrot, and tells him, I told them your message, but this is what happened. One of your friends fell down dead. Listening to that, the bird in the cage falls down dead. With a heavy heart, he opens the cage door. He takes the dead bird out. The moment he takes the bird out, it escapes from the cage and sits on a high ledge. The man is very upset. He said, I've taken such good care for you. Why did you do this for me? The bird sitting on that high ledge tells him, my friend in Africa gave me a message. So the man from below asks him, what is the message? He says, if you want true freedom, you must die before you die. So if you want true freedom, this is the message of Buddha also. If you want true freedom, you must die before you die. You must die the way you are. And what do you mean by dying the way you are? Right now, many of us are studying the Mundaka Upanishad. In the Mundaka Upanishad, the Upanishad brings a concept that there are two birds. One is a higher bird, which is just witnessing, doing nothing. There is another bird constantly pecking at very fruits, at one moment going into an ecstatic high, another moment going into moments of depression. Now, the lower bird is the bird that operates from the ego. It operates from the mind. The higher bird is the sakshi, the witness. Now, if you want to correlate Buddhist understanding, if the ego dies, and the whole effort of Buddha is to allow the ego to die. And once the ego is gone, the true self will surface naturally. This is how the great temple of Jerusalem looks today. 2000 years ago, around the time of Christ, Christ was walking around in the same temple. And the chief priest of this temple, is the picture that I've shown here, is a person called Nicodemus. Nicodemus could see a certain charisma in Jesus. But being the chief priest and Jesus was considered as a vagabond teacher. He had very ordinary people around him. He did not have the courage to go and meet Jesus during the daytime. And if you can see in this picture, you will see stars. So late in the night when the whole city slept, Nicodemus goes to visit Jesus. And he says, I have seen something of the glory in you. How can I be like you? The answer that Jesus had to give him was, unless you die, you have to die as you are for the real self to be born. The ego has to die. And that is the meaning of Vajrachedika Prajnaparamita Sutra. And this is one of the greatest sermons of Gautama Buddha. Buddha does not give you anything new. He has no message for you. His only teaching is to be here and now, to be very, very attentive, to live 100% in this moment. He does not give you any goal. There is nothing to achieve, to be blissful here and now, to live in awareness. Awareness is not a means to achieve anything. In a way, it is the end. It is the means also. All it says, how you can be in the world 100% in a way that the world will not affect you. And this is what Buddha called Samma Samadhi, the right meditation. If you want to be more, you have to be more. At this moment, can you be aware of your body? Can you be aware of the comfort or the discomfort of your body posture? Can you be aware of all the sounds in the background? Can you be aware of your breathing? If you are, you are in Samma Samadhi. You are in right meditation. What Buddha gives you is consciousness. And he says consciousness imparts being. The more conscious you are, the more alive you are to this moment. If you live a robotic life, that means if you live mechanically, you live unconscious to the real moment. There were two boys talking to each other. They were brothers. The younger brother asked the older brother, Anna, why should I say ABC? Why not ACB? So the older brother says, simple. First you must be, then you can see. This is the message of Buddha. Can you be here? Can you be now? Can you be you? If the meditator exists, it is wrong meditation. Right meditation is when there is nobody. Simply listening. You come to pure emptiness. Only then you will be able to understand the subtlety of these sutras. This is the painting of the scene of Buddha's death. And this is there in the temple at Kushinagar where he died. And as you can see in the scene, Buddha died between two sal trees on a Buddha Purnima day. He was born between two sal trees again on a Buddha Purnima day. He had his enlightenment on a Buddha Purnima day. It is said great beings like this are able to determine, you know, they have greater control on time. And now if you see the scene, you will see a lot of mourners, and prominent among them is Ananda. Ananda is an important character, one of the 10 principal disciples of Buddha. Ananda is actually his first cousin, older brother. And when Buddha became enlightened, Ananda wanted to surrender to Buddha. Now, in our tradition, the younger brother has to fall at the feet of the older brother. But here the older brother, when he takes sannyas under Buddha, now he has to touch the feet of a Buddha. So he took one condition. He said, I will surrender to you, but I want you to give me one condition. And the condition is, permit me to be with you all the time. Buddha allowed that to happen. From that moment onwards, Ananda was like a shadow of Buddha all the time with Buddha wherever he went. Now, at the scene of Buddha's death, Ananda was the biggest mourner. He was crying loudly. Buddha opened his eyes and said, Ananda, why are you crying? Of all the people, you had the grace to be with me the longest time. You should not be grieving. Ananda confesses, my Lord, I am crying not because you are dying. I have a very selfish reason. I have seen so many people who have been transformed, who have been enlightened in your presence. I have been with you for so many years, for 40, 45 years. In your presence, it has not happened. And if you go away, I will miss this opportunity for any number of lifetimes. This is why I am crying. Buddha looks into his eyes and gives him his final message. And this was his message to him. Apo Bipo Bhava. O Ananda, you have to become a light unto yourself. How long can you live in the light of another person? Ananda took this message so deeply. This message was so profound, it struck the heart of Ananda. It is said he just meditated on these words, Apo Bipo Bhava. You have to become a light unto yourself. It is said within 24 hours of Buddha's death, Ananda became enlightened. Ananda became realized. They saw another Buddha in Ananda. When Buddha died, they had a new crisis. For 40, 45 years, Buddha spoke, but they had not recorded anything that Buddha had spoken. So they had no records of what the Buddha spoke. So they called the first Buddhist council under the leadership of Ananda. And Ananda was asked to say what the Buddha said. And therefore, you will see all Buddhist scriptures will begin with these words. Thus, I have heard at one time. And therefore, you will see all scriptures related to Ananda will begin with these words. Thus, I have heard at one time. Ananda is being so humble. I do not know what Buddha said. I was not enlightened at that time. I'm not sure exactly what Buddha said, but this is what I feel. I feel this is what he had said. He never claims that this is what Buddha said. He says, thus I have heard at one time. So we go back to the sutra where Ananda is giving a very detailed commentary of everything that he has seen, what happened from the moment Buddha wakes up from the morning. The sutra goes like this. When he had eaten and returned from his rounds, the Lord put away his bowl and cloak, washed his feet, and sat down on the seat arranged for him, crossing his legs, holding his body upright, and mindfully putting his attention in front of him. For a Buddha, nothing is small, nothing is big. When he takes his bowl, he is very respectful to the bowl as he would treat God himself. When he puts his cloak aside, or when he puts his cloak on, he is so mindful. He is absolutely alert. He is not mechanical. And that is why in Buddhist sutras, again and again, this description goes on, because Ananda is so taken aback by what the Buddha does. When a Buddha does a thing, he is utterly there. He is nowhere else. Each moment he is living in total awareness. What he does is irrelevant. Every moment he is pouring his attention to whatsoever he is doing. To watch a Buddha is a blessing in itself. How he walks, how he sits, how he makes his gestures, and how he looks at you. Each moment is a radiant moment of awareness. Many years later, it is said for at least 500 years later after Buddha died, people worshipped Buddha only in the form of a tree. And that is why nobody can remember how a Buddha appeared. The Bodhi tree was worshipped for 500 years after the death of Buddha. About 200 or 300 years after Buddha, after the Kalinga War, when Ashoka became a Buddhist, he traveled to all the places connected to the life of Buddha and made various monuments at important places. This is the Dhammik Stupa, 10 kilometers from Varanasi at a place called Saranath, where a massive stupa has been put up by Ashoka to commemorate the first sermon. Buddha had his enlightenment in Bodh Gaya. He travels all the way to this place near Varanasi, and there he met his Guru Bhais, with whom he started his spiritual journey. And he gives a description of what is called this Anapanasati Yoga. Anapanasati Yoga is one of the Buddhist meditations. As you are sitting and listening now, are you aware of the breathing that is happening on your nostril? Are you aware of the breathing in? Are you aware of your breathing out? Buddha says, keep your attention directly in front of you. This was his first sermon. When his Guru Bhais saw something of the radiance of in Buddha, they asked him, my Lord, what is it to be enlightened? And his first speech was this, O bhikkhus, O monks, you know what it is to be enlightened. When I take a big breath, I know I have taken a big breath. When I take a small breath, O monks, I know I have taken a small breath. And when I take a medium-sized breath, O monks, I know I have taken a medium-sized breath. Friends, this is Buddha's message. This is it. Ananda continues his description in the Diamond Sutra. It goes on like this. Then many monks approached to where the Lord was, saluted his feet with their heads, thrice walked around him to the right, and sat down on one side. Now these three circles around Buddha are very symbolic. In Buddhism, there is an understanding of three refuges, which goes like this. Buddham Sharanam Gacchami, Sangham Sharanam Gacchami, Dhammam Sharanam Gacchami. And Osho has given a little different meaning compared to what I understood about it. Buddham Sharanam Gacchami, what does it mean to come in the presence of a Buddha? It means to come a space from a space of not knowing. I do not know anything. I come to you in pure innocence. I bow down to you and I am ready to receive whatever you give. That is Buddham Sharanam Gacchami. I cease to exist as an individual. I'm here totally surrendered to you. And the next beautiful understanding that Osho gives about Sangham Sharanam Gacchami, normally I would have shared with all of you, that is when a Buddha is not there, when we are in satsang, I surrender to this group of friends who are committed in search of truth. But Osho gives a different meaning. He says Sangha means all the great masters who have lived in the past, in the present, in the future. I surrender to Jesus, to Krishna's, to Sai Baba's, to all the gurus in the past until the present guru in front of me and up to the Adi Guru. All these are different names by different traditions. But when I say Sangham Sharanam Gacchami, I surrender to all the Buddhas, the commune of the Buddhas, past, present, and future. And finally, Dhammam Sharanam Gacchami. Dhammam Sharanam Gacchami, I surrender to the path taken by a Buddha. A Buddha is also referred to as well gone, the one who succeeded in his path, the one who has gone beyond. And that is why we do Pada Puja, because we respect the footwear which represents the path taken by the Lord. Now is the scene where Subhuti will come to a Buddha and ask him a question. And before that, how to ask a Buddha a question. It is said, you can ask disrespectfully, Buddha will give you the answer, but you will not be able to receive it unless you are very receptive, unless the answer of a Buddha. So how you ask a question determines whether you will be able to receive the answer or not. To ask a Buddha a question is not like asking a question to a professor. This story was related yesterday by Dr. Kiran. It is said that Maulinga Putta is one of the books. He comes to Buddha with many, a large group of people, and he says, I have a dozen questions to you and I want you to answer. He literally came to Buddha with the challenge that you have to answer these questions. So Buddha looks at him and says, I can answer these questions, but I have one condition. I will certainly answer all your questions, but there is one condition. You have to stay with me for 1 year in silence. When Buddha uttered these words, Sariputra, who was sitting nearby, laughs loudly. Maulinga Putta gets very embarrassed and he says, why are you laughing? And Sariputra replies, 1 year ago, I had come to the same Buddha with my questions. And he told me the same condition, stay with me for 1 year. 1 year has passed. After 1 year, not only my questions, I have disappeared. He tells Maulinga Putta, this man is very deceptive. If you have any questions, you ask it now. 1 year from now, not only the questions will have gone, you will also disappear. And that is what Buddha does. He cuts you. He cuts your past. He takes everything away and gives you your pure self. And that is what we see in the Mundaka Upanishad as the Sakshi, as the higher bird. So the real question is, how to ask a question? Are you coming from curiosity? Are you coming from your accumulated knowledge? Is your question innocent? Are you trying to test this person? Now, these are not the attitudes with which you come to a Buddha. You need to be very humble. You need to have surrendered. Only then you will be able to receive the answer. Only if you are ready to take the seed that the teacher gives you to your heart. You will see so many times, even before you complete the answer, the student asks a counter question. So when the teacher gives you the answer, you have to be very receptive. You have to take it to your heart. Buddha very often uses this word, I'm not a philosopher, he says, I am a physician. Buddha introduced many people. It is said more people than anybody else in the planet, he has led them to God, but in a very, very rational way. First, he says, you have to be very receptive. You have to attain to silence. Only then communion is possible. Buddha would never answer any metaphysical questions. This happened exactly with Nisargadatta Maharaj. When anybody asks him any philosophical questions, Nisargadatta Maharaj was a Panbidi shopkeeper. He would say, Ye mal, yahan nahi milega. You will not get these products here. Buddha would never answer any metaphysical questions. He was always ready to answer questions about methods. His approach was very scientific, like in science. Time and again in our medical practice, it happens, people come and ask this question, doctor, why did I get this brain tumor? Or why did this family member of mine get this brain tumor? We have no why answers. But if they ask you how to get over this, is there a treatment? What can we do? Now we have an answer to the how. I will continue with the Diamond Sutra. Now here comes the scene. Buddha is sitting, paying his attention in front of him. At that time, the Venerable Subhuti came to that assembly and sat down. Now Ananda gives a description of Subhuti. Then he rose from his seat, put his upper robe on one shoulder, placed his right knee on the ground, bent forth his folded hands towards the Lord and said to the Lord, it is wonderful, O Lord. It is exceedingly wonderful, O well gone. how much the bodhisattvas, the great beings, have been helped by the greatest help by the Tathagata. How then, O Lord, should one who has set out in the bodhisattva vehicle, how to stand, how to progress, how to control thoughts? You will see so much of similarity between the Sitta Prajna questions where Arjuna asks, you know, how does a Buddha stand? How does he sit? How does he walk? How does he talk? But here there is a slight difference in the perspective. Subhuti was one of the great disciples of Buddha. And again, Subhuti is what is called a bodhisattva, almost a Buddha. What is a bodhisattva? A bodhisattva is one who is ready to become a Buddha, who is Buddha in a sense, who is 99% Buddha. He is ready to evaporate. He is trying to remain at 99% for some time so that he can help people like us out of his compassion. Because once he reaches 100%, he is gone, as we saw in the Hridayam Sutra, Gate Gate Para Gate Parasam Gate Bodhi Swaha. It is extremely difficult once a person has attained to enlightenment to come down to our level. Buddha could come down. Sariputra, Subhuti is now finding it extremely difficult to remain on this shore. And that is why his question, how to stand, how to control thoughts, because the other shore is pulling me. Now that is where he requires help from a Buddha. And Buddha tells him, I want you to stay on this shore a little longer because now you can share your light, your compassion, you can understand these people. Now, this is the description. And again, the description of Subhuti is Samma Samadhi, right mindfulness. Buddha uses this term for himself, Tathagata. Tathagata literally means thus come, thus gone. Another meaning is well gone. The person who has successfully gone across to the other shore, one who has attained to the ultimate of meditation, gone altogether. One who is completely empty of his lower self. The self has disappeared, the lower bird has gone, the one who has evaporated. And this is the question that he has, Subhuti has to the Lord. And Buddha is trying to tell Subhuti, I want you to stay in this shore for just a little longer so that you can help people. I know that the attraction on the other shore is so much. The pull of the other shore is so much. But I want you to stay on this shore for a little longer. Now, this is the difficulty that Subhuti is having. The difficulty he is having is now he knows that all our miseries are false. Now he knows that what we are afraid is only the rope, thinking that it is a snake. Now that we know that all our suffering is just like a dream, we see that in our medical practice. If a person comes to us with a genuine problem, with a genuine pain, you have some techniques to help. But if a person is coming with a psychological problem, not that a psychological problem is not genuine, it is not a physical problem for those of us who are trained to deal with physical disease, and therefore we are not able to help such a person. To these people, this is the answer that Buddha gives Subhuti. After these words, the Lord said to Subhuti, therefore, Subhuti, listen well and attentively. Someone who has set out in the vehicle of a bodhisattva should produce a thought in this manner. Osho gives the Sanskrit word called chittopad and elaborates what is chittopad. Chittopad means every bodhisattva should create a very strong determination. The determination is that I should take everyone, as many beings are there in this universe under the domain of beings, I must take everyone to nirvana. Not just my family members, not all the people I know, everyone around me. This is the instruction of Buddha to his disciples. Not one, not two Subhuti, but all beings, all men, all women. I want you to take them to that realm of nirvana, which leaves nothing behind. And yet, he gives them a warning. Remember, don't have a sense of ego that you are taking somebody, because even if you have that ego that I am helping somebody, you fall back. So always remember, don't get lost in becoming a savior, but at the same time, help people to go across to the other shore. Now, Buddha has started the wheel of Dharma. And this wheel of Dharma over the years is slowing down. And Osho says, my job is to revive the whole cycle that what Buddha has given. Through this sutra, I want you to all become bodhisattvas. This is Buddha's message in his first sutra. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.